Hi, my name is Ryleigh. Today I will be talking about my group's research on the 1980 eruption of Mount St. Helens. Before we dive into learning about the actual eruption, it might be helpful to know some background information. Let's start by asking the question, what is Mount St. Helens? Well, Mount St. Helens is a large stratovolcano located in Skamania County, Washington. One super cool thing about it is that it began forming 40,000 years ago. This happened when two tectonic plates, called the Juan de Fuca and North American plates, collided and created something called a subduction zone. This means that the collision of the two plates caused one to be pushed under the other. The estimation about the volcano's age was made from the age of some of the ash deposits around the volcano. Now, Mount St. Helens gained its notoriety following its huge eruption in 1980, but this was not the first time it had ever erupted. It is believed that it erupted about 23 times before 1831, and its last eruption prior to 1980 took place in 1857. Now that we know a little bit about this volcano, let's get into its most infamous eruption. To do that, let's go back to 2 months before the eruption to discuss the events leading up to it. On March 16th, 1980, the volcano suddenly came back to life. It started to generate a series of earthquakes, which lasted until March 27th. At this time, the volcano had its first eruption in over 100 years. This eruption blasted a crater that spanned 75 meters in the volcano. Following the March 27th eruption, a series of over 100 small eruptions and explosions took place. These eruptions caused the previous 75-meter crater to grow to a staggering 400 meters. These volcanic events came to a halt on April 22nd and didn't occur again until May 7th. This time, they only lasted for 10 days, but were accompanied by thousands of small earthquakes. This bout of volcanic activity led to the formation of a bulge on the northern flank of the volcano. This means that the volcano had begun to swell from the presence of magma that had risen high inside of it. Immediately following these events, the volcano finally had its huge eruption on May 18, 1980. This began with a 5.1 magnitude earthquake, which caused the swollen northern bulge to break away from the volcano and slide down it in the largest volcanic landslide in history. This was followed by a series of extremely powerful lateral eruptions. These eruptions blasted out of the volcano at a horizontal angle and caused the debris from the landslide to be hurled through the air at 300 miles per hour. However, this volcano was far from finishing its devastating chain of events. Even more eruptions of ash and tephra, or rock fragments, followed the initial eruptions. This alone was enough to devastate an area of approximately 600 square kilometers. But it still wasn't over. Pyroclastic flows were generated by the volcano as well, which caused ash, lava, and gases to be ejected. These pyroclastic flows are the reason that the pumice plain that surrounds the volcano was created. In addition, lahars, or volcanic mudslides, were triggered and caused even more damage to the area surrounding the volcano. Following all these events, a period of complete darkness came over parts of eastern Washington as a result of wind blowing volcanic debris through the air. Now that you know about the events that ensued at Mount St. Helens, I'm going to talk about the environmental and societal impacts of the volcanic eruption. As a result of the events of the 1980 eruption, several parts of the environment were altered. For starters, the summit of the volcano was destroyed. This happened when the 5.1 magnitude earthquake that I mentioned earlier caused the summit to slide off the face of the volcano. In addition, many rivers surrounding the volcano changed their course, and many new lakes and ponds were formed. Wildlife in areas affected by the eruption were either killed or had their sources of food and water destroyed. Ash and debris carried by the wind following the eruption remained in the atmosphere for weeks and were carried all the way into the Rocky Mountains. In addition to the environmental impacts of this huge eruption, society felt a sting as well. 53 people were killed directly by this volcano, and 4 died from indirect causes, while even more had to be hospitalized for respiratory issues following inhaling contaminants produced by the volcano. Many of those who survived the eruption still suffered from PTSD because of it. Hundreds of structures around the area of devastation were also destroyed. Although it may not seem possible, the 1980 eruption of Mount St. Helens also had some positive impacts. The 1980 eruption of Mount St. Helens was instrumental in the study of volcanic activity. This was because it was the first of its kind to be studied through modern volcanology. Additionally, this volcano was able to be viewed and studied from multiple different vantage points due to its easily accessible exterior. Studying this volcano also allowed for better warning systems to be created because it highlighted the importance of tracking volcanic activity and making the public aware of risk before it becomes too late. Another outcome of this event was the realization of the importance of having multiple different types of Earth scientists working together to monitor and research volcanic events. This is because it is important to understand every aspect of the factors that contribute to volcanic activity. I hope that you've enjoyed learning about this volcano and its most prominent eruption.